Single, just 2 seconds.
Ja, ja.
So, let me start by thanking everyone who has survived this whole intensive 2 weeks process. And it's my real pleasure to introduce Professor Josef Hofbauer from the University of Vienna, who is going to talk about evolutionary dynamics for games with continuous strategy sets.
Thank you. I apologize, I did not prepare myself very well. So I have to give the talk on the blackboard. I want to talk today about games where the set of pure strategies is not necessarily finite, as in most part of the talks up to now, but is a rather arbitrary set. And in particular, there are many games of interest where this set of pure strategies is a continuum. The pure strategies can be a continuous variable. One example is the sex ratio game that was mentioned yesterday, where the strategies are the probabilities of producing male offspring versus female offspring. Or another example is the war of attrition, where the strategies are simply the time, how long we want to wait. And in this game, the more patient player who outsits the other one will gain the prize. So there are many such examples, and I want to talk about some of the problems, or actually only one problem in this area that is a bit different compared to the finite case. And just to recall things, the replicator dynamics for a finite strategy space looks like this. Pi dot is Pi. Pi is the frequency of strategy I in the population. This is the payoff for I. This is the average payoff. And one problem that I, or the only problem that I want to address is under which conditions is a pure strategy stable or asymptotically stable. And, or in biological terminology, a monomorphism, where the whole population uses the same pure strategy. When is this stable? Now, for finite games, this is trivial. A necessary condition is that AII is larger or equal to AJI, so the diagonal element in the corresponding diagonal element is the largest in its column. And conversely, if there is strict inequality here, then it is asymptotically stable. This is often also called a strict Nash equilibrium, the unique best reply to itself. And this is completely trivial. You show this by linearization at the corner of the simplex. Now, if we have a infinite set of pure strategies, this is not so obvious, and that's the problem I want to discuss today. And so for most of the applications, we will stick to S being an interval of the real line, but some of the things can be done very generally. Namely, one can take a measurable space, S, with a sigma algebra, and P of S, which is the generalization of the simplex, is the set of all probability measures on this space. And our payoff function, which here was a matrix, is now a function from S cross S to R. We are still keeping to symmetric two-person games. And so this must be a measurable function. And for simplicity, let's assume it's bounded. Then we can extend the payoff function to mixed strategies. X against the mixed strategy is this integral. And the bilinear extension to mixed strategies would be this. And then we can write down the analog of the replicator dynamics in such a measurable space. And that's given by this differential equation. So the probability B is a measurable subset of S. The probability of such a set B changes with time according to this expression here. And if you assume that S is a finite set, if S is finite, and you take S1 to Sn, and F of Xi, Xj, you abbreviate as Aij, and you take here the B as one of these single sets, then you easily see that here you get out the Pi, and this is simply the difference between the expected payoff for strategy X against the average payoff in the population. So this is the natural extension of the replicator dynamics, which is the basic evolutionary dynamics for games. And that's the...
Can you write similar equations for the other?
Yeah, one can do that, yes. Yeah. And yeah, then... And the basic problem that arises here, namely existence and uniqueness of solutions, in the set of probability measures, this was solved long ago by Bomtze in a PhD thesis under the supervision of Carl Siegmund. And so the question that I want to deal with is the stability of pure strategies. So the stability of a point measure, delta S hat, a certain pure strategies, and this is the corresponding point Dirac measure. When is this stable under this replicator dynamics? Of course, then there is immediately the question of which topology. There are two, like here, in this general setting, we only have the variational topology, and that's where you prove existence and uniqueness of solutions. But if the more interesting case will be when S is a metric space, maybe compact metric, and then the set of probability measures will again be compact and metric, or metrizable, if it's taken with the topology of weak convergence of measures, which I will call the weak topology, or weak star topology. And so but we immediately restrict to the case that now S is an interval. And suppose that the origin is an element of S, and suppose our payoff function is given by fxy, and the question is, yeah, we are now interested in the stability of the point measure at zero. Now, by analogy to this here, we need that a necessary condition will be that this element is larger than f of x0 for all x in S. This is a necessary condition for stability. This you simply get by restricting the dynamics to the set 0 and x, to these two pure strategies. And then the replicator dynamics boils down to the two strategy replicator dynamics. And then you can apply this. And so you get this as a necessary condition for stability. And of course, if now f is smooth, let's assume that, then we get that this function here has a maximum at x equals 0. So the derivative with respect to the first variable must be 0. And the second derivative with respect to the first variable must be less or equal than 0. So if you make a Taylor expansion around 0, then we get f naught naught plus this vanishes plus some constant times times y, the second partial derivative, plus then we get the quadratic terms, which I denote by ax squared plus bxy plus cy squared, and then we have high order terms. And then you remember the lecture by Carl Sigmund. He said that the replicator dynamics remains unchanged if to the payoff matrix we add an arbitrary constant to one of the columns. So we can do the same here. So we can add or subtract any function of depending only on y without changing the replicator dynamics. So we can get rid of this linear term here. And we could get rid of this. But we don't do that. But what we do is we replace the c by a. And the advantage now is that also this we can get rid of. So what we get is f of xy is ax squared plus bxy plus ay squared, and then maybe plus higher order terms. But for the moment, I will restrict to this simple game with this quadratic payoff function. This is the lowest order approximation nearer a pure strategy, say zero, if our strategy space is an interval. And the advantage here, as you see, is now that we have a symmetry in the payoffs, so it's a so-called partnership game, or it's what also it corresponds to the selection, Fisher selection model from population genetics. So this would also be the simplest example of a diploid continuum of alleles model. Okay, and this will be helpful.
Perhaps some argument of Moore's lemma to get rid of the high order terms. Changing the measures, perhaps.
I'm not sure whether this works. But that would be nice, yeah. Okay. So we have this. And this condition here means that for stability, we need a is less or equal than 0. And let's suppose a is negative for simplicity. Now the question is this sufficient for stability? In the finite case, it would be. But is it in the infinite case? And I want first to give some heuristics. Sigmund mentioned yesterday this adaptive dynamics. In adaptive dynamics, one assumes that for games with a continuous strategy space, the population is monomorphic for all the time. Of course, that's in contradiction to this model, because here every monomorphism is a fixed point. And we are interested in the dynamics of polymorphisms. But let's ignore this difficulty. And the essential idea in adaptive dynamics is, suppose the population is composed only of the strategy X. And now there is a nearby strategy Y, such that this holds. Then Y, an invader with this strategy, would have an advantage against everybody in the population, so he would spread. And the philosophy of adaptive dynamics is he would spread and take over the whole population, and the population will be replaced by this new strategy Y. And forgetting all the details of the dynamics in between when the population is polymorphic. And it will, and this is going on all the time, so the new pure strategies will come in, and they will come in the direction of the gradient of this function. So the partial derivative in the first variable evaluated at the point x. This is the adaptive dynamics. And in this case, for this particular game, if we compute this, we get 2ax plus by. If we compute this partial derivative, evaluated at y equals x, and this gives 2a plus b times x. So according to adaptive dynamics heuristics, the trait, the strategy x, will change according to this differential equation. And the origin, or equilibrium of interest, is a equilibrium here again, but it will be stable in this adaptive dynamics only if 2a plus b is negative. And this is called convergence stable. Or CSS. This was introduced by Ilan Eschel. And this adaptive dynamics is a dynamical story behind this. But it's completely oversimplified and something which a priori has nothing to do with this. But you see, this condition is completely different from that one. So let's do a slightly better heuristic. Instead of assuming that the population is monomorphic all the time, let's assume it's Gaussian distributed. So we look at probability distributions Q, and now for simplicity we take S to be the whole real line, so that the probability density function is 1 over root of 2pv, v the variance, e to the minus, I always forget these things, x minus the mean value squared divided by twice the variance. Let's look at such Gaussians with arbitrary mean, arbitrary variance. Now it turns out that for this particular simple payoff function, the set of all Gaussian distributions is invariant under the replicator dynamics. And on this two-dimensional space, the dynamics boils down to a system of ODEs, namely V dot is A V squared, and M dot, the mean, changes according to 2A plus B times M V. So, and we see both of these parameters come in here. So if A is negative, this condition here that we got from the intuition from finite strategies ensures that the variance goes to zero. So we go to the monomorphic case, whereas the mean of the distribution follows basically the adaptive dynamics. So this heuristics, this beta heuristics, suggests that both of these conditions are necessary for stability. And actually that's what is true. We can prove the following theorem. For this particular payoff function, if A is negative and 2A plus B is negative, then the point measure at the origin is Lyapunov stable. And it's Lyapunov stable in both the variational topology and in the weak topology. And how do we prove this? For this, we use this information that we have here. So it's a partnership game, and for a partnership game, that's actually a genetic situation. We have the so-called fundamental theorem of natural selection, which says that the mean payoff, F of PP, or the mean fitness, which is double integral FXY PDX PDY. This function here is monotonically increasing along every solution of the replicator dynamics. And it's monotonically increasing and strictly increasing whenever this is not a stationary solution. So this is monotonically increasing. Now, this implies that every strict local maximum of this function is a Lyapunov stable point. So let's compute this for this particular game, this double integral. So this will be the integral of this with respect to PDX. So that's the A times the second moment, M2 should be the second moment, x squared PDX plus. Then we have B, and BXY gives the first moment integral x PDX, but also times y PDY, so the first moment squared, plus for the last term another second moment. And this we can rewrite. You know, the second moment is the variance plus the mean squared. So this is 2a plus the times the variance of the probability measure plus, and then we have 2a plus b times the mean of the probability measure squared. And now you see we have here the a, and here we have the 2a plus b, so these are our two parameters, and if these are both negative, then this expression is negative, and it takes the value zero only if both the variance and the mean are zero, which is the point measure at zero. So the point measure at zero, under these two assumptions, is the only, is the global maximizer of this function, and so it is Lyapunov stable, because this function is continuous. And one can also show the converse, basically. If, say, if this here is positive, then this function here has a saddle at the point measure, and it's increasing in the along the point measures if we move the from zero away to x, the value is increasing, and so one can show that if this is Lyapunov stable, at least in the weak topology, then both of these inequalities must hold with weak inequalities. So we basically...
So
in this direction. Why do you say only Lyapunov stable? There's also arguments saying that it is locally asymptotically stable.
Yeah. But you believe Lyapunov stable?
Yes.
So if we take a level set, okay. So we have Lyapunov stability. Now the problem is it asymptotically stable? Then if we take the variational topology, we have the trouble that because of lack of compactness, the limit set of an orbit could be empty and in general will be empty. And if we take the weak topology, then we have nice compactness, but the price we have to pay is that if here is delta zero and here if delta, we have a continuum, each of the point measures give us a continuum of one of rest points arbitrarily close to our given point measure. So in principle we cannot have asymptotic stability because it's not isolated. And it could be that orbits, a lot of orbits converge to some of these point measures nearby, simply. We cannot rule this out. That's the major problem. It seems that this mean fitness argument does not help us much for proving asymptotic stability. And furthermore, there is another principal problem with asymptotic stability because of this. If x here is close to zero, then any initial probability measure whose support is, say, an interval nearby but which does not contain the origin, if we let this evolve, then from the replicator dynamics, we see that the support of the measure is invariant under time. And in the limit, we can get only a measure whose support is contained in the initial support. So starting from such an initial measure, which is close in the weak topology to this, we can never converge to that. So asymptotic stability is in principle not possible in infinite strategy spaces. So we have to weaken the concept a bit. And the strongest possible concept I suggest to call weakly asymptotically stable if for all initial probability measures near p hat in the weak topology, such that the support of p hat, we want that this converges to p hat. Yeah, first, we should ask that p hat is Lyapunov stable, as usual. And second, the convergence, we ask that this should imply that Q converges to P hat in the weak topology. But because of this argument, a necessary condition is that the support of P hat is contained in the support of the initial point Q. And so this is the best we can hope for. And let's call this weakly asymptotically stable. Now the question is for our quadratic payoff function, is the under these two conditions, is it weakly asymptotically stable? And how can we prove this? Now we remember again what we know in the finite case, where we know quite a bit. And here, if the matrix is symmetric, then the stable points, the asymptotically stable points, are characterized, as I said already, by the strict local maxima of the mean fitness function. Has a strict local maximum at p hat. But this we used already for stability, and this does not work. And another characterization is that p hat is an ESS, is evolutionary stable strategy. And proving this uses a Lyapunov function, namely the usually product pi to the pi hat. So this is equivalent that this is a local Lyapunov function. And so let's try this technique.
Can I back up a bit and ask a question? Because I sort of got lost. You mentioned that the Gaussian distributions, they are invariant.
If we take S to be the whole real line, but now we are working again on a compact interval.
Do you have a dynamics? I see a Riccati type equation popping up there. Perhaps if you have more Gaussians, is it likely that you're going to have some simple dynamics for the...
Maybe. I have not tried that. Could be that it's still... I don't know. So,
that would be a very interesting...
Yeah. But for the... If you're interested in the compact interval, then this is only a heuristical tool, of course, which gives the right intuition, but...
Yeah, what I was thinking is perhaps you could try to model these different individuals by putting Gaussians at these guys.
Yeah.
With a small variance so that...
Yeah. Yeah, I have not tried that. That's an interesting idea to pursue. Okay, and so let's make a definition. P hat is an ESS. Yeah, what's an ESS? For finite games, there are many different characterizations. Carl Sigmund mentioned some of them. It turns out that for infinite games, they all become different. And historically, the weakest of those has been taken as the definition of ESS. And in this, our case, it is the same as a strict Nash equilibrium, namely A equals zero. But in my opinion, it was the wrong definition. One has to take the... So since many of you are not familiar with this area anyways, I define ESS here not according to the tradition. And we take the strongest possible definition, namely for all q near p hat in the weak topology, we have f of p hat against q is larger than f of q against q. And this is what we need to make the usual Lyapunov functions work. And then we can prove the following result. If p hat is Lyapunov stable and an ESS, then it follows that p hat is weakly asymptotically stable. Note there's a difference in finite games, Lyapunov stability itself would follow. Basically because all the topologies coincide in the finite case. But here we need, at least in the proof, we need the Lyapunov stability as an extra assumption, plus this ESS gives us this best version of asymptotic stability that we can hope for. And the proof, again, is based, first of all, on extending this Lyapunov function from the finite case to the infinite case, and this was done in the proper way already by Manuel Bomze. He saw that one has to reformulate this Lyapunov function a bit, take the logs and normalize it. If you take the log, we get a relative entropy, and what one really has to do is to take the so-called cross entropy. So the integral of log dp hat over dq p hat dx. So this is the cross entropy of the two probability measures p hat and q. Q an arbitrary initial condition, p hat our stable equilibrium where we want to go to. And this function is non-negative, and it's can attain the value infinity. So in order to make it finite, we have to make some assumptions here. So this is a Radon-Nikodym derivative. If we call it phi, then this will be phi log phi times integrated with respect to q, where phi is dp hat differentiated with respect to the measure dq. And to make so that this is bounded, we better assume that phi is a bounded function. So we require for this that p hat is absolutely continuous measure with respect to q, with respect to the initial condition. Now, if p hat is a measure with full support, with a nice positive density, like in the war of attrition or so, this is works nicely. However, in our case, the p hat is a point measure. And so this makes sense only if the initial measure q has a positive mass on zero, something which is a heavy assumption. We want to start with say densities or something. So this works only in this case. So we had to modify this idea a bit, and the trick, the basic trick, is to replace the p hat, the equilibrium where we want to go to, by a nearby strategy, by a nearby probability distribution p tilde, which is whose support is contained in the support of q, and which is absolutely continuous with respect to q, and which has a bounded Radon-Nikodym derivative. And it's easy to see that one can approximate the p, every measure p hat by such things. And this gives us a not a truly Lyapunov function, but at least a function that works like a Lyapunov function for a long time, and it will drive us at least in the neighborhood of this p hat, and as close as we want. And then together with the assumption of Lyapunov stability, we can ensure that we will never go away from p hat again, and p hat is the only possible omega limit point. That's the trick here. Okay, so let's apply this technique to our problem. So we have to check when is the point measure an evolutionarily stable strategy according to this new definition. So we have to compute f, and p hat is now the point measure, so it's 0, q minus f, q, q. We look at this difference, and this must be positive. And this is given by, that's a similar calculation like this here. The f was ax squared plus bxy plus ay squared. So x is taken to be 0. So here we get a times the second moment again, minus, and here we get what we computed here. So minus, this goes away again, but we have another minus here, and minus b m1 squared. And replacing again the second moment by the variance plus the mean squared, we get minus a times the variance of q, and now we get minus b times the variance, minus a, and another b, so we get a plus b m1 squared. And when is this negative? It's negative if a is negative and a plus b is negative. So if these two conditions are satisfied, then our point measure is a ESS, and we can conclude weakly asymptotic stability. But now compare the condition that we, for Lyapunov stability, was a negative and 2a plus b is negative. This is a bit different. Is it stronger or weaker? This is a bit, that's a stronger condition. So we get something out, but not, there's a gap. So we are left with a gap. So if this is the b-axis, here is somewhere 0. Somewhere we take a negative. So here we have minus a, and here we have minus 2a. In this region here, we have instability. Point measure is unstable because the mean fitness function is a saddle. In this region here, we get ESS. So we get weakly asymptotically stable. In this region here, we have the CSS condition from adaptive dynamics or heuristics, and at least we have Lyapunov stability. So what can we say about asymptotic stability, about convergence to the point measure in this region here, from minus a to minus 2a? That's left open by this approach. And so it turns out for minus a smaller or equal than b, we have delta 0 is not weakly asymptotically stable, according to this definition here. But we have the following result, a weaker result. If the support of the initial measure contains the origin, which is the necessary condition anyways, and if this is an interval, we need connectedness of the support, then the measure as it evolves along the replicator dynamics will converge in the weak topology to the point measure. So if the support is connected, then it works. And also if the gap, it could be disconnected if the gaps are small enough. It will also work. So the result here is that in this region here, in this region we have the largest possible basin of attraction. And here the basin of attraction is slowly shrinking. And at this value, predicted by adaptive dynamics, it turns into instability. And so what happens here, that the set of orbit initial conditions that really converge to the point measure at zero get smaller and smaller and more, but it's still Lyapunov stable. So the orbits stay nearby and maybe converge to another point measure nearby or some other fixed measure nearby. But at this critical value, most of the orbits then go, or at least some orbits go far away. And the proof for this is a bit tricky, and it uses basically the original definition of the idea of adaptive dynamics. So if we have this point X, then this strategy Y close by but to the left will be able to invade this. So we have this inequality. If Y is to the left of X, and it turns out a simple computation shows that if we replace the second here by any point Z in the interval from minus X to X, in this interval here, this still holds, luckily. And so this means that Y, the strategy Y, strictly dominates the strategy X. And then by an argument similar to elimination of dominated strategies, one can show that the mass near X as compared to the mass near Y is going to decrease monotonically. And by a careful examination and repetition of this argument, one can show that the mass at the outermost point is going down and down, and so that the only possible limit point will be the point measure at zero. But for this argument to work, one needs always a little bit of positive mass. One needs full support here. Otherwise, this argument would break down. So that's the result for this. And maybe this was only for the truly quadratic pair of functions, the simplest case. If one takes the higher order terms, then some of the arguments still work. The Lyapunov stability, the mean fitness, does not work anymore because the game is no longer a partnership game necessarily. But fortunately, this argument here works. This elimination of strategies works. So this result can be applied locally. And so we still know that the CSS condition implies convergence to the point measure if we start with a measure of full support, close enough to the pure strategy in question. Okay, thank you. Yeah, in this case, I only know the latest by Oechsle and Riedel. They have a result. And using this Lyapunov function, one can, from initial conditions where this function is finite, you will have convergence to the
measure which is given by the exponential.
Yeah. But yeah, that's it. Convergence to from appropriate initial conditions.
I have one question. I'm trying to develop a little bit more of intuition on examples. So, as I understood, you are using X on the line.
Yes.
So you are close to make the analysis close to AES from the point dynamics. Is that correct? At least in the beginning of the talk.
Yeah, the main assumption was that it should be a strict Nash equilibrium. So corresponding to that, it's in the starting from this condition here.
Yeah.
Basically, you compare the say zero, which is our equilibrium, with any other pure strategy X, so you get an edge.
Okay.
And on this edge, you compute the eigenvalue, and this gives you, as a necessary condition, this here for all x. That's a necessary condition for stability on all the edges. And from that, one gets that this function here has a maximum. So if we take the quadratic approximation, we have a negative. And so the quadratic payoff function I was studying is the lowest order approximation near such a.
So you're fixing one of the edges at a time, at every time, or?
Yeah, if I compare zero with any other strategy X and look on this edge, then only if this payoff is larger than this, I have local stability on these two strategies subgame. And for stability, I need this in all subgames, in all two strategy subgames.
Does it
so this is a necessary condition for us for stability. Okay. And so we, in a continuous strategy space, this is the lowest order approximation.
Does it make any sense to consider a point situation in which you wouldn't have a Nash equilibrium on a vertex and make it a...
If it's not a Nash equilibrium, then it's definitely unstable anyways. Then it will move away along one of the...
Yeah, but I was thinking if the Nash equilibrium was somewhere sort of inside the...
Aha, if it's a mixture.
Yeah. Would it make any sense to do the probabilistic game?
Sure, there? Sure, yeah. Yeah, yeah. There are many, like the Vorov attrition is an example for that. And some of the results on the way, like this here, apply also to that situation.
Thank you. Yes?
Yeah.
How about just the countably many strategies?
With countably many, I think it's still. I don't know. Yeah. How is it? There are still already problems with countably many strategies. I think there are already problems with countably many strategies also. Yeah, yeah. There can be complications. As soon as your state space is infinite dimensional, you run into troubles maybe. But here this framework with a continuous strategy space is nice because we can do a Taylor expansion and all this.
When you talk about the water of attrition, is that example in which the solution is the Poisson distribution?
Yeah, an exponential. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is that one that you're talking about? Okay. Any other question, comment? All right. Okay, so let's thank again. Thank you. So we meet again at 1:00.